It's good to see you again tonight. Thank you for being here. Aunt Matilda called some of our people today and said that she had a ingrown toenail and needed the family to come over. So some of the families went over to wrap up Aunt Matilda's toe tonight. But we're glad you're here to hear the gospel once again preached. I appreciate so much you being in your places. And it is an honor for us tonight to have Brother Knox back with us. I appreciate him very much. It's an honor, and I said this morning, I don't mean to be repetitious, but I mean this. It is an honor to have him, not only in our services, but it is an honor to have him on our radio station. And I'm thankful for the time through the years. You know, after you've been pastoring for 40 years, and you hear somebody, you can pretty much detect the depth of their dedication, the depth of their study, the depth of their preparation. And as you hear Brother Knox on the radio, it's very obvious. He didn't get up one morning and turn the mic on and just start talking. He has spent a lot of time preparing himself to prepare other people to serve the Lord. And we are honored that he can be with us, dear friend. He preaches kind of like a circuit riding preacher. When he comes in this time of the year, he was preaching this past week down in Salisbury. And how many of you ever heard tell of Bear Trail Baptist Church? Well, that's where he'll be preaching tomorrow night. Bear Trail Baptist Church over in Virginia, and then some other places here in Carolinas. And we're glad that in this tour he's able to work us in. It's an honor to have him. Let's welcome him back tonight to the pulpit of the Berean Baptist Church.
Thank you, brother. Amen. Well, I probably told you this before, but I like it so much. Students all went back to school the first day after the holidays. And the teacher asked young Patrick Murphy, "What did you do at Christmas time?" And Patrick addressed the class, "Well, Miss Jones, me and my 12 brothers and sisters go to midnight mass and we sing hymns. Then we come home late and hang up our stockings, and we're all excited. We go to bed and wait for Father Christmas to come and bring our toys." "Very nice, Patrick. Now, Jimmy Brown," teacher said, "what do you do at Christmas?" "Well, Miss Jones, me and my sister also go to church with Mom and Dad, and we sing carols and get home late. We put cookies and milk by the chimney. We can hardly sleep waiting to get up the next morning and see our presents." Well, it went on like this until the teacher, embarrassed, realized there was a Jewish boy in the class. Little Isaac Cohen. She didn't know what to do, but she had to call on him. She said, "Now, Isaac Cohen, what does your family do at Christmas time?" He said, "We do the same thing every year. Dad comes home from the office. We pile into the Rolls Royce. We drive down to Dad's toy factory. We get inside and look at all the empty shelves, and we sing together, 'What a friend we have in Jesus.'" Yeah, it's kind of like that. 1 Peter chapter 5 tonight. 1 Peter chapter number 5. We've got a positive message and a negative message all rolled into one. And I'm never quite sure how it's going to go, but we'll read our verses together and see what we can see. 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse number 5, the Bible says, "Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another, and be clothed with humility. For God resisteth the proud, and giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour." Father, help me tonight to speak the truth in the way that you'd have it spoken. I pray, Lord, you'd help me to make these things clear to the people that have come. And I pray, Lord, that you'd help all of us to take these things to heart and apply them to our lives. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. We are right to make much of the grace of God. And I'm so thankful for the grace of God. And we are right to tell sinners that they can come to the Father by the Son and be saved. But I think much of our evangelism, I think it started with Mr. Graham, and I'm not here to praise him or to criticize him, but many things have crept into our churches and into our evangelistic messages that are more humanistic than they are Bible. And when we make our soul winning or our witnessing centered upon the lost person instead of centered upon God, we've lost the proper perspective. God saves sinners by His grace in accord with His Word and in accord with His holiness. He doesn't save sinners by His grace because He's brokenhearted without them and because heaven wouldn't be the same if you weren't there or in the rest of this. God is the preeminent being in this universe. He sits upon a throne as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And if I didn't get saved and go to heaven, He would have plenty of beings there to praise Him and plenty of people there to praise Him. In fact, He was doing quite all right before I came along, and He'd be quite all right after I'm gone. And I heard a few weeks ago a song that I hadn't heard in decades, and it's a pretty song, and it's got a catchy melody. And as sure as I say this, somebody sang it here 2 weeks ago as a special, and I'm not meaning to be critical. But there's a song, and it was real popular about the time I got saved. It is no secret what God can do. What He's done for others, He'll do for you. With arms wide open, He'll pardon you. It is no secret what God can do. And we have this picture in our mind from a lot of preaching, and this picture in our mind from, well, just a lot of loving ourselves, that God is in heaven with His arms open wide, saying to sinners, come on, come on, come on. And yet when you read the verses we just read, God, in fact, is sitting on His throne, stiff-arming the proud and unrepentant sinner and keeping them away from Himself. Look what the Bible says now. See, I like to say something like that because people sit back in shock. Well, no, wait a minute, that can't be. We just read it. For God resisteth the proud. He is pushing against people who are seeking to exalt themselves and to get to heaven on their merits, or imagine that they are going to heaven because they are so deserving. And God, rather than having His arms open to embrace such pride, He has His arm held out, pushing such proud persons away from Himself. Come on, it's Sunday night. We can take this. Look at the next verse in verse 6. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God. You're not in His arms. You're not in His hand. If you're an unsaved person clinging to your pride and your self-righteousness and bragging about your good deeds and boasting of your merits, you are under the hand of God. That is, He's sitting upon His throne, pushing down upon your forehead and keeping you away from His holy presence, because He has no use for man's pride. You know, if you think with me back, we can't read two chapters, one in Isaiah and one in Ezekiel. But if you think back to what the Bible says about the fall of Satan, it doesn't say once Lucifer walked into a bar. It doesn't say that once Lucifer solicited a prostitute. It doesn't say that once Lucifer robbed a bank. It said he's beautiful, he's musical, he's powerful. But he said in his heart, I will ascend, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God, and God threw him down. Not because he was smoking or drinking or cussing or chewing or chasing women, but because in his heart he was lifted up with pride. And how could anyone know who God is and be proud? I'm really concerned, and your pastor could elaborate upon this, and I'll let him do that when I'm gone and heading off down the road. But how can a man devote his life to reading the Bible? How can a man devote his life to learning about and ministering the truth of God to people and have an ego and be proud and stuck in himself? It's abhorrent in anyone, but much more in a man standing in a pulpit as though somehow he were some superior being. I'm telling you something, God pushes back against all of that. And yet look in our passage, and here's where I really want to spend the evening tonight, because all of us have victory over pride, I'm sure. Humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. Now look what happens. That hand of God that is pressing down against the proud, the moment that individual humbles themselves, God flips that hand around and lifts them up. And thank the Lord for it. God is not in this position if you're unsaved here tonight. He's in this position. His arms are not open to welcome you. His arm is held out to push you away. But the moment you will yield under that mighty hand, and the moment you will surrender to that almighty God, he will then turn and lift you up and bring you into those open arms of love. And thank the Lord for it. And so tonight I want to consider this with you. From one end of the Bible to the other, I find these incredible, blessed records of people who have done terrible things and lived horrible lives being saved by the grace of God because they humbled themselves. And I search in vain from one end of the scripture to the other to find a proud, unrepentant person who ever found salvation. And I'm telling you tonight, it's not what you've done. If you're here tonight, you're not saved. It's not what you've done that'll take you to hell. It's your pride that is your one-way ticket to a lake of fire. Because God can forgive anything in a person who's repentant. But he will forgive nothing in a person who stands before him with their chest stuck out and their chin held high, boasting about their merits and their good works. Now, if you think I'm out of line, I encourage you to try something new this year. Show up for visitation. And go out with those who are trying to win souls and listen to a steady stream of people when you say, are you saved? Are you going to heaven? And they all say yes. And you ask them, well, how is it that you're going to heaven? And they will begin to tell you how good they are or how religious they are or what spiritual deeds they've done or what bad deeds they've never done. And you will find by the end of the night that you wish you could find someone who would say, I am trusting in the shed blood of Jesus Christ to save my sinful soul. Because people sure do like to brag about their good works. And so consider with me, first of all, a man in Exodus, the second chapter. We can't read all of these chapters tonight. But he was a slave, and I wouldn't want to be a slave. That's a good place to say amen. He was a servant. I wouldn't want to be another man's servant. And his people had spent over 400 years under the lash of Pharaoh's taskmasters. And this man was strong and healthy and vibrant in the prime of manhood. And he saw an Egyptian taskmaster brutally beating, cruelly treating one of his fellow Hebrew slaves. And he rose up against that Egyptian and slew him. And he buried that man's body in the sand. He said, well, I can understand his feelings. Well, a lot of us can understand his feelings. And I get where he would be that angry, and a lot of us would. But the fact of the matter is, however upset you are, you don't have a license to kill. But Moses killed a man. And he buried his body. And the news got out. And Moses hit the city limits running and ran on out of that wilderness. And he spent 40 years in exile from his people and from the ministry to which he was born, serving time for killing a man. I wouldn't recommend you kill anybody. One day, Moses out there tending sheep, and he saw a bush burning, and the bush was not consumed. I'd like to see that. And Moses said, I will turn aside and see this great sight. And as Moses made his way over toward that bush, God Almighty spoke to Moses from out of that burning bush. And you know what he said? He said, take your shoes off, Moses, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Now, come on, think about it. Doesn't that sound like a weird thing for God to say? Wouldn't you expect him to say something like, offer a lamb and a sacrifice? Wouldn't you expect him to say something like, promise to live for me the rest of your life? But God said to Moses, that's my ground you're standing on, and I don't want your dirty shoes on it. Take your shoes off. Now, you know what? Moses could have said, you understand that I was specially born. Do you understand that my mother hid me? Do you understand that I grew up in Pharaoh's palace? Do you understand that I smote that Egyptian in defense of your people? Do you know what Moses did? Moses stopped what he was doing, and he reached down, and he took off one shoe, and he threw it outside the perimeter of God's holy ground, and he reached down, took off another shoe, and he threw it outside the perimeter of God's holy ground, and when God saw that man humble himself in the presence of the Lord, God gave gracious, saving blessings to a man who had murdered his neighbor. Now, I'm telling you something, brother. I would not recommend you kill a man. But I'm telling you, this gospel that we preach can be taken into the prisons and the jailhouses and the rescue missions and the rehab centers and the VA clinics. And we can tell men and women who have taken the life of another, if you will humble yourself, the God who has pushed you away your entire life will turn that hand and lift you up and give you everlasting life. That's our God. He resists the proud, but when a murderer humbles himself, God will save that man. I'm so thankful for that. You know, I read about another man in my Bible. And if anybody had a right to brag and boast before God, it would be a man that built something that no one had ever built before. He built an ark. I don't know about you, I believe the biblical story about the ark. It's the first day of the year. I read through that story this afternoon one more time. And it's just, I've never found any fault with it whatsoever. The scientists don't believe it. That's okay. They change the science books every year. They've never had to change the Bible. What God wrote in the Bible, it's still just the same as the day he wrote it. If your brother went off to college this year, and next year you wanted to go off to college, and you said, well, I won't buy textbooks, I'll just buy my brother's textbooks, you couldn't use his science textbook because they can't talk about global warming anymore because it turned out to be a fraud. When I was in high school and college back in the 70s, it was an ice age. How many of you remember that? We're all going to freeze to death. It's going to be so cold, we're all going to die like the dinosaurs. Dinosaurs died because they wouldn't quit smoking. That's what killed the dinosaurs. Cigarettes killed them off.
Where do you get that from?
I don't know. Where do you get that? Got hit by a meteor or a comet? Noah built that ark. And Noah got all those animals on that ark. And Noah sailed that ark through that flood. And Noah got out. And man, listen, if everybody had something to brag about before God, it was Noah. But after he got off that ark, he planted a vineyard, and there's nothing wrong with that. And he grew some grapes in that vineyard, and there's nothing wrong with that. And he harvested some grapes from that vineyard, and there's nothing wrong with that. But he let some of them ferment, and there's something wrong with that. Thank you, two of you. And there's something wrong with that. People say, well, preacher, how much drinking you think is too much? God said not to look at it. That's what he said. He said, look not on the wine when it's moving in the cup. That's what he said. He said it's stuff start fermenting. You don't even look at it. That's a fact. I can tell you right now, guaranteed, young people, guaranteed, listen, I can tell you right now how to make sure that you don't have a predisposition to alcoholism, never take a drink. I can tell you how to make sure you never get drunk. Never take a drink. The sixth drink can't get you drunk if you hadn't had the first five. That's a fact. Anyway, Noah, he fermented those grapes, and then he drank them, and he got drunk. And while he was drunk, now listen to this. While he's drunk, Ham came in. Not if you knew Christian. This little chunk of meat didn't walk in. A man named Ham came in where Noah was. And the Bible said when Noah woke up and knew what was done, what had been done. You know the Bible tells about murders. The Bible tells about kidnappings. The Bible tells about wars and bloodshed. Whatever happened while Noah was drunk was so horrible, the Holy Spirit wouldn't put it in the Bible. I don't know what it was, but it's pretty bad. You know, here's another reason, young lady, why you should never be drunk. Here's another reason why you should never take the first drink, which will keep you from ever getting drunk. Why would you want to put yourself in a state where something could happen to you that you wouldn't be able to describe or tell about when you sobered up? Why would you want to do that? But Noah, he's drunk, he's passed out drunk, he's something unspeakable has happened while he was drunk. Yet when that man repented of his sin and humbled himself before the Lord, the God of grace had mercy on that drunkard, and you never read about him taking another sip the rest of his life. Listen to me, please, listen. I hope there's no one here that's a drunkard. I hope there's no one here that's even started down that road. I hope there's nobody here has a single can of beer in their house. I hope nobody here has any liquor hidden in their cabinet that you claim is just for cooking with. But I'm telling you something. If you've spent decades of your life passed out drunk and addicted to liquor, I'm telling you, the God that is pushing you away because you're too proud to repent, the moment you'll humble yourself and say, Lord, forgive me and save me and deliver me from this devil of drink, I'm telling you, he'll flip that hand around and lift you up and save your soul. Drunkenness won't take you to hell, but refusing to repent and humble yourself before the Lord will. In Joshua 3, the children of Israel are making their way across the Jordan and into the promised land. And before they do so, they sent two spies in to spy out a city called Jericho. And when they got there, they're running from the law. They were seen and they're going to lose their lives. They don't find a hiding place. And they ducked into the only place that was open that late at night, the house of the harlot Rahab. And the commentators like to make her a hairdresser or a seamstress or a maid. But the Word of God said she was a harlot. That's what she was. It doesn't say she used to be a harlot or she was a retired harlot or a reformed harlot. She's a harlot in Jericho. That's a cursed city. And this woman is engaged in a cursed profession. Now, I'm going to say this without any hesitation, and I know your pastor going to back me up on it. I wouldn't be here if he didn't agree with me, and I wouldn't be here, vice versa. I'm just going to tell you something. Forget Hollywood. Forget the movies. Forget the TV shows. There is nothing more degrading in this world than for a woman to make her living as a harlot. And the only thing equal to it is a man who would go unto the house of the harlot. Now listen, Hollywood glamorizes prostitution. Hollywood makes the beautiful movie star, the working mother who's dancing in the nightclub to put her daughter through college. Where? Find me that person. Have you ever seen the mug shots of the women arrested for prostitution? They don't look like movie stars. And the money they make, I'm pretty sure, is not going to tuition. It's going to meth and cocaine and whatever else it takes to get yourself through the shame of selling yourself as a harlot. It's a low-down business. May I say to you that in Hebrews chapter 13, brother, sister, God puts the adulterer and the adulteress in the same category as the harlot and the man that goes in unto the harlot. See, in the Bible, this is a good thing to say on the first day of the year on a Sunday night. In the Bible, any sexual activity outside the bonds of marriage is forbidden, is a terrible sin, and it brings the judgment of God upon it. America's lost their mind. They're so mad and crazy about sexual sins that they have justified them to the place where if you say something about it, you're some sort of freak or monster. I'll be glad to be a freak and a monster both if that's what qualifies you. Somebody sent me one of these little picture things, and it said, if you need to be in here, and it had a symbol for a men's restroom, and you go in here with where my daughter is, and it had a symbol of the woman's restroom, in the future you will need to go in here, and it had a picture of a handicap restroom. I thought that's pretty good. This country's lost its mind. They have sunk so deep into perversion that they think you're perverted if you find fault with their perversion. All right, now having said all that, that harlot said to those two spies, I heard what your God did to the Egyptians. And I know what your God is going to do to our people. Is there any way that I can be saved? And they told her, if you'll hang that scarlet thread in the window, and she did. That harlot didn't say, who are you to judge me? That harlot didn't say, one God's as good as another. That harlot didn't say, well, I just believe everybody goes to heaven when they die. That harlot humbled herself. They said, hang that scarlet line in the window. I've always imagined she just knitted some great big rope thing together just to make sure they didn't miss it. And you know, she called her family together and told them the news and brought them all in. And the Bible says those children of Israel, they marched around Jericho and marched and marched and marched. On that last day after the last march, they blew those trumpets and shouted, and the walls of Jericho fell down. Except for one piece of that wall, with Rahab's house sitting right up there on the top of it. In 1998, my wife and I were on a bus, and we drove south down out of Jerusalem, and the tour group got out, and the guide said, here is the ancient hill, and on top of this hill was the old city of Jericho, and we walked up this walkway. He said, look, you can see scattered all down this hillside in every direction, still there, stones and rubble scattered where those walls fell down, and you get up to the top, and there's one section of brick standing, so wide, so long. And there's a sign there that says, atop this piece of wall stood the house of Rahab the harlot. It's still standing. The wall where Rahab waited atop that wall, trusting in a God she'd never known prior to hearing a report, is still standing to this day. You know what Jesus said? He looked at those scribes, he looked at those Pharisees, he looked at those proud religious people with all their ceremonies and their sacraments and their rituals and their prayer beads and their phylacteries. And he said, the harlot and the drunkard enter in and you're locked outside the door. You know why? Because God resisteth the proud. But what's he do? He'll turn that hand around and give grace to the humble. and Moses a murderer, and Noah a drunkard, and Rahab a harlot, are all found in the roll call of faith in Hebrews 11. That's an amazing thing, isn't it? There's a king one time. He wrote some great songs. One time he wrote a song, he called it Psalm 23. It was number one on the charts for about 30 weeks in a row. I mean, people, they played it on the radio every hour. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. It's a big hit for David. And later in his career, he wrote Psalm 119, and hardly anybody bought it. It filled about five LP records. It just went on and on and on, and 150 verses or something like that, 176 verses. Who can listen to a song that long even once? But David wrote a lot of songs, and he fought a lot of battles. He killed a bear one time with his hands before Davy Crockett ever did it. David, just a shepherd boy, killed a bear with his hands, killed a lion with his bare hands. Don't you hope God let us see some of that? Hope God's got it in a library up there somewhere. And on a Friday night, we all get together, and God says, tonight I'm going to show you. I'd like to see David taking that lion by the beard and holding him there and just slapping him upside the face and then killing him. That'd be something to see, wouldn't it? Bible says he did it. Killed Goliath. Cut off his head. Fought those Philistines. Then one night, he's up walking on the roof of his house. And he looked down the road and he saw a woman bathing herself. And instead of saying, oh, dear God, forgive me, I shouldn't have seen that going back in the house, he let the lust of his flesh take hold upon him. He had that woman summoned to his chambers. She said, I'm married. He ignored it, committed adultery. She sent him a text message a little bit later. That's in the Living Bible. She sent him a text message and said, I'm with child. You know what David did? He used the power of his office as the king to order Joab, a military general, to have that woman's husband killed in battle. Isn't that a horrible thing? Adultery, thou should not commit adultery. Murder, thou should not commit murder. He put the bottle to his neighbor's lips. Tried to get the man drunk. The man wouldn't drink. I mean, David, he's as deep in a hole as he can be. And Nathan the prophet walked in, knocked on the door. David's from his big desk in his office. Who is it? It's Nathan, your majesty. Come in. And Nathan the prophet walked in, put his finger right in David's face, said, thou art the man, you're a dirty sinner, you're low down, God knows what you did. And David, listen, David hit the floor, put his face in the dirt of the ground and cried out, God, be merciful. God, help me. I wouldn't recommend you ever commit adultery. I wouldn't recommend you ever play the harlot. I wouldn't recommend you ever get drunk. I wouldn't recommend you ever kill a man. But I'm telling you something, none of those things will take you to hell. If you'd humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, He would lift you up. He would exalt you. You won't go to hell for committing those sins. You'll go to hell for dying in those sins when you kind of humbled yourself and sought the grace of God. A man named Peter. We all like Peter because he made a mess of things. Not many people say that. I'll tell you that Apostle Paul, I can really relate to him. But a lot of people say that's Simon Peter. I tell you, I understand that fella. He left his fishing nets and followed Jesus, and he always had something to say when he shouldn't say something. But when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, some soldiers came to arrest him. You remember the story? And Peter took out a sword, and he's going to fight for Jesus. He's going to defend Jesus, keep him going to the cross. And it says he cut off the ear of one of the servants. How do you do that? I don't know much about swords, but it would be mighty hard to take a sword and cut off somebody's ear. Well, it didn't say he took off his ear and his arm. That'd be this way. It doesn't say that he cut through his chest and took his ear out on the... I don't know what he did, but he took the guy's ear off. Probably not good to have a fisherman handling a sword. That's probably not the best way to do things. Anyway, Jesus reached down and put that man's ear back on the side of his head and healed him. That's pretty good. And he told Peter, said, put that sword away. I keep trying to tell you I'm going to die in Jerusalem. That's what I came to do. Well, Peter, some say he's embarrassed, some say he's angry, some say he's confused. But he just walked off. And next time you see him, he's warming himself with the Lord's enemies at their campfire. And somebody said, aren't you one of his disciples? And he just flat out denied. He said, I am not. I don't know the man. That's pretty low down, wouldn't you say? Somebody asked him a second time a little later that evening, said, aren't you one? You sound like one of his disciples. He said, I am not. I'm not. I don't know him. That's bad. That's really bad. A little while later, the Bible says, a maid, just a young girl, she said, art not thou one of his disciples? And the scripture says he began to curse and to swear and say, I never knew the man. Come on, isn't that horrible? After all the miracles he'd seen, after all the sermons he'd heard Jesus preach, after all the wonders he had beheld, he's cursing and swearing and denying that he knows the Lord. Jesus goes to the cross. He dies. He rises from the dead. A few days later, Peter's out in a fishing boat. He's going back to fishing. The Bible says he's not properly clothed. You ought to read this, what it says. And Jesus standing on the shore, calling, calling. And the Bible says when Peter knew it was the Lord, he threw his coat around him and dove into the water and began to swim for shore. That's not logical, is it? Threw his clothes on and then dove in the water. And he didn't want to wait for the boat to get there. Thought it might take too long. He's swimming. He gets up to the shore. And Jesus made breakfast. He didn't say anything to him. And they had a meal together. Didn't say anything to him. And then here's all his buddies sitting there. Fire's going. Fire. People. Peter. Jesus. And Jesus says, Simon, do you love me? You know what he's got to do? He's got to eat some crow. He's got to humble himself. Lord, can't you see him hanging his head? He's so ashamed. Lord, you know I love you. Okay, just checking. A few minutes later, Jesus looks across that fire. Simon, do you love me? Lord, you know I love you. You can almost hear Peter thinking, I wonder if he's going to ask me three times. He knows. He's got to know. Simon, do you love me more than these? Lord, you know I love you. And you know what Jesus did? That proud and haughty man who spent 3.5 years rebuking Jesus and telling him, you're not going to the cross. Far be it from thee. That proud and haughty man that said, I don't agree with what Jesus did in that garden. I don't even know him. And Peter humbled himself. Jesus put that hand underneath him and lifted him up and said, why don't you just go out and start my New Testament church? I'm telling you, I would not recommend that you ever curse or swear or deny the Lord. But I can also tell you tonight on the authority of Scripture, if you've done that, if you will humble yourself, God will forgive you and have mercy upon you because that's what He likes to do. One more and then we'll read our verses again. As Jesus Christ hangs bleeding upon the cross, There are men on either side of him whose lives have been so horrific that a government full of unsaved heathen don't consider these two men fit to live. And they are crucifying two thieves, malefactors on either side of Jesus Christ. And the Bible says they are both wearing out Jesus. They are cursing him. They are mocking him. And somewhere in the midst of that 3 hours that afternoon, one of those thieves began to see himself for what he really was. And he began to see Jesus for what he really was. And he stretched that dying neck out a little bit as far as he could. And he said to his criminal buddy on the other side of Jesus, "Don't you fear God? Don't you know we're condemned? And don't you know it's just?" You know what he said? "We are dying justly. We are receiving the due reward for our deeds." And then he looked at Jesus and said, "But this man hath done nothing amiss." He wasn't talking that way when he got to the cross. When he got there, God was up in heaven, pushing, 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 pushing. He's going to push that man right into hell. That's the God of the Bible. He's going to do it. That man said, "I deserve to die. And this man dying next to me does not deserve to die." And he said, "Lord, did you know that before it was written, this man proved Romans 10:9? For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." He said, "Lord," by the way, "Lord" is not in the lips of the dying thief in the New International Version. That's a shame. I wouldn't have that Bible. I'd keep the Holy Bible. He said, "Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom." And Jesus turned that bruised and bloody and beaten head, looked at that man who lived as a thief, who lived as a malefactor, who is dying a condemned criminal, who probably never done one thing right in his life. And Jesus looks at a man who can't get baptized, who can't pay a tithe, who can't make restitution, who can't do one good deed ever in his life. And Jesus said, "Today, thou shalt be with me in paradise." You know what happened? The hand of God that pushed against that man his entire life, on his death bed, and it wasn't much of a bed, when he humbled himself and called on the Lord, God flipped that hand over and lifted him up and saved his soul. Now let me say this before we read our verses, because I think I'm talking to saved people tonight, or for the most part I'm talking to saved people tonight. Maybe you killed somebody. No, don't raise your hand. Maybe you've been drunk. I don't want you to raise your hand. Maybe you played the harlot. Maybe you committed adultery. Maybe you've cursed and sworn, denied the Lord. Maybe you've stolen something. Do you not see that God saves sinners? Wretched sinners, vile sinners, lifelong deep sinners, if they humble themselves, but not before and never without it. But may I encourage you this year, as you look into the faces of the parents of some of those bus children, as you hear the blasphemy of some of your co-workers, as you consider the grossly immoral lifestyles of some of your neighbors, do you understand from what we've thought about tonight, there's not one of those people that God can't save? There's not one of those people who does not deserve a gospel witness, because that harlot can be saved. That drunkard can be saved. Keep that nursing home ministry going, because here's a man who got saved in the last hour of his life. Aren't you glad that God saves sinners who humble themselves? Now come back to our passage and let's read it together again. I want to show you one more thing for our week together. Man, when the Lord said, your life's a vapor, he wasn't kidding. Doesn't seem like we were just here together. It seemed like I was just standing here. And just like that, a year, it's just gone. Now verse 6, before I read it, let me tell you about my mother. My mother was the perfect balance to my father. My father is very violent. Man, he's a very angry man, at least toward me. And it seems like I could never do anything right in my father's eyes. My mother, if you asked my mother, you'd have to press her to get her to say that I'd ever done anything wrong. It just was a great balance there. But my mother was preparing me for the ministry from the time that she taught me to read. Ministry from a King James Bible. And she would do things like this. I'd come home from school and I would say, we had a cookie jar. How many of you had a real actual, we had a real actual cookie jar on the counter. It wasn't just a myth. There was a cookie jar on the counter with cookies in it. And I'd come home from school and I'd say, Mom, can I have a cookie? And she'd say, well, of course you can. And I would start for the cookie jar and she would put her hand on my shoulder and say, but you may not until after supper. Now that's mean. But she knew that one day I'd be standing in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, preaching on a passage about can and may, and that I would need to explain something to you about God and about the devil. Can I have a cookie? Of course you can. Can is power and ability. But you may not. May is permission. Brother, sister, listen to me. God is almighty. He's the creator of the heavens and the earth. He can save anybody anytime he wants to. But you know what the Bible says? You must humble yourself so that he may exalt you in due time. The God who can save you is only going to save you when you give him permission to do so. Come on now. Does the Bible say God is not willing that any should perish? It does. It says it twice. The Bible says God created nothing, nothing except for his pleasure, and that he has no pleasure in the death of the wicked that he should die. Okay? So if God got what he wanted tonight, everybody would be saved. But God abides by his word that he's spoken. And those that he can save, he will not save until they humble themselves and say, Lord, you may save my soul. Come on, look at it. 1 Peter 5:6. Humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God that he may exalt you in due time. Now look at consider the devil. Can he not destroy every one of us? I don't want to pick a fight with him. I don't get a wrestling match with the devil. He can drag my soul to hell and your soul and every soul in this world. He can take them to hell. It's prepared for the devil and his angels. But there's a lot of people there. But look at this. Verse 8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil is a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. If you're here tonight, Satan can take your soul to hell, but only if you permit him to do so. You say, I've been a terrible person. Very good. That's the first step to getting saved. I've done some awful things. Thank you for saying that instead of bragging about your good deeds. Why not tonight, if you're not saved, why don't you say to the devil, you may not have my soul. and turn to God and say, Lord, I am so sorry for my sin. You may save me right now. And that arm that's been resisting and resisting because your pride is such an offense to God, when you humble yourself and call upon His name, He'll flip that hand around and lift you up and seat you with Christ in heavenly places because He's a God of grace. Please, don't get me wrong tonight. We absolutely believe in the grace of God. But we don't believe in the mythical grace of John Calvin. You are not saved because God saves by grace. The Bible says, for by grace are you saved through faith. See, until you come by faith to Jesus Christ, you never receive the saving grace of God. What keeps people from coming to Jesus Christ? It's not murder. It's not drunkenness. It's not harlotry. It's not adultery. It's not stealing. It's not cursing and swearing. What is it? It's pride. It's pride. Brother, sister, whatever you've done, God can forgive it as soon as you repent of it. I know that's old-fashioned. But the primitive preacher is here to set the stage for the primitive quartet. I believe these primitive truths need to be proclaimed, sung about, preached. If God was going to save by grace, everybody in the world would be saved. But He saves by grace through faith. And what do you have to believe by faith? Christ died for our sins, according to Scriptures. See, until you get dealing with that sin thing, you're not going to get saved. Aren't you glad to read in the Bible about these people that God saved? Isn't it a blessing to your heart to see how low down some people were when God's long arm lifted them out? I hope you're thankful tonight for your salvation. Hope you appreciate tonight what the Lord has done for you. And if you're not saved, don't tell me about what you have done or haven't done. I'm telling you on the authority of the Word of God, the Lord has His hand right on your forehead and He's just pushing you away and pushing you away and pushing you away. And He'll do that till the devil takes you right into hell if you don't humble yourself and get saved. But the moment, look at that thief on that cross. The moment you bow your heart before a holy God, He'll turn that whole thing around forever. Hallelujah. Father, we thank You as sincerely as we know how that You save by Your grace every sinner that humbles themselves and puts their faith and trust in Your great mercy. Thank You, Lord, for showing us the depths of sin out of which You've brought so many. We pray, Father, if there's one man or woman or boy or girl here tonight that's never been saved, that they'd start the new year with new life in Jesus Christ. In His name we pray. Amen. Amen. Pastor.
Let's stand together with our heads bowed, our eyes closed. There is no greater decision an individual ever make than the decision of salvation. Maybe you're here tonight. Maybe there's been a question mark. Maybe you've thought about dying and you think about it occasionally. And when you do, you don't have the peace that you should have because you just feel like there's something unsettled in your soul. He's brought the message tonight. And now it's up to the individual to accept it or to reject it. Everybody has that choice. But the most grave decision anyone will ever make is to reject the overtures of God's mercy. And I wonder if there'd be one here tonight who would say, while our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed by an upraised hand, I really have some doubt about my soul. I have some doubt about where I'd be in eternity if something should happen to me tonight. And I want you to pray for me. I need to know for sure. I need to get it settled. I want you to pray for me. Anywhere in the building, would you slip your hand up and let me pray for you? You're here tonight and you would say by an upraised hand, God spoke to me tonight. about some things in my life. God very definitely, through the preaching and through the Holy Spirit and through the Word of God, made an impression upon my soul this evening. And I want the Lord to know that I got the message. And Pastor, I want you to help me pray about some things. Would you slip your hands up in the building tonight? Thank you. Thank you. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the message tonight. I pray during these moments when so much is at stake. A person's very soul could be hanging in the balances in these next few moments. We understand that. And what a tragedy it would be if, because of pride, what other people would think or say, someone would not step out tonight. Rather take a chance on going to hell forever and being concerned about what somebody might think about it. I pray tonight. I ask you tonight, through the presence, Holy Spirit of God, I know you will. Lord, please speak conviction where conviction is needful. Then help folks to have the wisdom, to have the knowledge, the ability to respond to your overtures of mercy. We'll love you and thank you for it, because we ask in Jesus' name. If you need to come tonight while our heads are still bowed, our eyes are closed, I want to ask you to slip out right now. Whatever the need is, whatever the problem is, or problems that might be in your life, Spirit of God speaking, I want you to come right now. Make your way down as the Spirit of God speaks. You know, when someone brings a message of this magnitude, my mind goes back to the first church I pastored many years ago. I was there for 4.5 years. 35 people who were church members when I went there got saved. Some of them were holding positions in the church, and they got saved. I think the great tragedy would be if somebody slipped off of a chair, opened their eyes in the flaming inferno called hell, going out of a church into the regions of the damned forever. What a tragedy that would be when there was no need of it. Because God is a God of mercy and grace. If you need to come, we're going to sing a stanza of invitation. You might have some doubts about your salvation. You should come tonight and get it settled. There might be some areas in your life the Spirit of God's speaking to you about. This is the time. This is the way we get the new year started off right. Thank God for the altar field this morning. Thank God for that. Maybe you did sufficiently this morning, and yet maybe God still continues to speak to someone this evening about a specified need in your life. I want to ask you to come. Dear Jesus, we love you. Thank you, Lord, that you are a God of mercy. But then we understand that heaven is acceptance of an invitation. And I realize we don't go there. We don't go to heaven by carte blanche. Lord, thank you that you have made salvation so plain, so simple, so powerful, that we can accept that and believe and be saved. Ask us, Lord, Lord, help us tonight as we ask you to minister to these needs. I pray you'll continue to speak to hearts in Jesus' name. Let's sing a stanza. Need to come? Would you come?
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you. He's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Knox. Appreciate it very much.